Now we're going to jump in and take a little bit more of a slant into directly into Hyper-V and talk about some of the virtual machine configurations that we have here. Specifically, we're going to talk about some of the Hyper-V settings and some of the networking that goes on here. One of the things that we have that we've built in since 2008 R2 SP1, and that's when we introduced it, was dynamic memory. And this was a common request that we wanted to be able to do those types of things like they do with memory ballooning inside of our virtual machine environments, where we can specify, grow and shrink our memory as we need it for those virtual guests. So yes, we do support it. However, one of the things I want to be very clear on, and VMware will give you the same advice, you want to make sure you plan this out very, very well. Because what happens if you run out of physical RAM for your virtual machines? If you're actually using your virtual machines and there's no more RAM, where do they go? They go to disk to fulfill those need requests. Well, what happens? That generally will slow down those virtual machines a lot. So one of these things, when you're doing this virtual machine memory, there's a lot of technologies that we do under the covers as well as VMware to make sure that we try to avoid that scenario where you're actually hitting RAM. Because at the end of the day, you only have a finite amount of RAM on your servers that you can leverage and use for those different things. So some of the things that we actually do inside of Windows Server is we actually give you minimum and maximum startup memory. And I'll show you where all these are in the settings in just a few minutes. We do things called smart paging, which I'll talk about in the next time. We can actually do runtime configuration. You can increase the memory without having to restart those systems. So you have the ability to kind of have that, hey, I need to increase this workload, or I can give it a range. And you'll see that here in just a minute. We have smart paging. Smart paging is all about when do I want to use my memory versus my actual hard drive space. And there's going to be times when you've given a virtual machine a certain amount of RAM, and it's not using that amount of RAM. But there might be requests that need to use or leverage that RAM. It's Hyper-V's way of basically saying, hey, you know what, for this particular access, I can move this down to page file or down to disk while that request is being used. But the minute that VM says, I need that memory back, I'm going to give it back inside of it. And that's very similar to what hypervisor swapping does for VMware. And smart paging is just our way to be able to handle those requests when we get out of that band and out of that concept of memory that we use inside of our environments. Okay. Remove page memory after virtual machine restart. And then eventually that memory is going to come back as reclaimed after our startup. So we have ability to work with those types of things like memory. Moving on quickly into virtual hard drives. This is our VHD, VHDX are our hard drives. These are compares to our VMDK. Just a couple things that you might be interested in. We actually support up to 64 terabytes inside those VHDXs versus 2 terabytes for a VHD. So even with our own technology, we really grew how big these virtual hard drive files can be that store our virtual machines and work with them. There's a lot of things we've done with storage under the covers to help protect them underneath the covers, optimize structure for large sector. We've increased the storage protection. We've done a lot of things to really improve how our virtual hard drives work and how they're leveraged inside of the environments. So when you look at these types of things, we can do a lot of things. And that's not even addition, not even talking into, and I don't think it's anything we're going to get into today around snapshots and how we handle snapshots of these files. But we actually do that same kind of level of thing. Oh. Side note, because I got a question early on. Matter of fact, one of my counterparts, Julianne, actually emailed me a question before we started. Somebody was on early and asked me a question about DCs and domain controllers. Just real quick before I forget, because I just talked about snapshotting. One of the important things that we put into Windows Server 2012 Active Directory. Now, folks, this is not a Hyper-V or virtualization topic. This is AD real quick. We actually make it virtualization safe now. So you can actually, if you remember in prior versions and even earlier versions of VMware, we said don't virtualize your domain controller. Okay, you virtualize your domain controller. Don't take a snapshot. Okay, you took a snapshot. Don't ever use the snapshot. And then you use the snapshot, and what happened to your DC? You had GUI rollback, and chances are that DC stopped being a DC. Well, in 2012, Server 2012, we actually introduced a new attribute, basically a hypervisor GUI ID, a virtualization GUI ID in a sense, to control that. And I'll put a link to an article later in the chat when I get when Tommy's up next. But basically, at the end of the day, with our VHD files, we now can handle that snapshot rollback because we actually track the attributes inside of Active Directory. It was such an important fix to AD. We actually exposed the API, and VMware adopted it as well as we did adopt it with as Hyper-V, as you might imagine. So we're doing a lot of things to help understand the capacity of how that storage under the covers is using. Speaking of those VHD files, specifically on the VHDX files, we can actually resize them dynamically online. I hear a big hooray. This is something we introduced with R2. We can even shrink them if we want to as well online. So we can grow and shrink our VHD files dynamically through our tools inside the virtual machines that we have. So we have the ability to leverage additional space, something that VMware had for a while, and we actually just added. And I don't think as of yet VMware can shrink, but I'll be surprised if they can't do it. But we can now grow our VHDs online inside the environments. Storage quality of service. Now, this is interesting to me. When we talk about this, we talk about IHOPs, and really, you know, I like how we understand the metric and how we look at how we can improve this, and you can trust the performance mod tools that are there. But what's interesting to me is that I don't think anybody really cares so much about the storage quality of service, although it's fairly easy for us to implement. I think you care more about latency and how do we handle the speed down to that storage. How can we get to the storage? And Tommy mentioned something earlier when we talk about storage and processing those files around using RDMA adapters. Well, one of the things that RDMA does, it gives you an immense amount of bandwidth down to that storage. And it's kind of the future of, I think, most people that are going to be virtualizing workloads are going to look at RDMA down to that actual storage. Depending on what you're trying to do, and I have Jeff Woolsey has done a couple demos on this, they've run into problems where the RDMA storage got so fast and it just couldn't go any faster, and they didn't know where the bottleneck was, and they thought it might have been the storage, but it wasn't the actual storage drives themselves. What they found out when they actually did all the investigation, that our latency down to our storage and to our actual things with these RDMA adapters, the bottleneck becomes memory. Now, wait a second. Did Matt just say memory? Yeah, I did. Think about that. How long do you wanted storage, speed the storage to go faster than the memory bus that we have inside of our environments? What happens there is we have an amount of just an amazing kind of amount of stuff that we can do for that to work with. So understand that when we look at this, latency is important as well. Let me just speed past this slide. And something we put into R2, virtual fiber channel. This is something that being able to use virtual fiber channel from our host is important. But more importantly, how do I actually use virtual fiber channel inside of my virtual machine, so my virtual guests can actually get in and use the virtual fiber channel that we have today. Well, one of the things we actually put in it, and really it's just a yes, we actually do this. We support endpoint virtualization ID. We can actually do up to 4 virtual machines channel adapters on that. We have multipath IO functionality, so we support a lot of the common functionality. But remember, this is not just talking about our host. This is actually talking about our guests accessing that storage directly to help maintain their storage, and more importantly, it's supported across live migration. I put this in the category of, yeah, we should have been doing this for some time to go on and work with it. Let's switch gears and talk about some of the Hyper-V networking basics for just a bit. There are 3 main types of networks that we have inside of our Hyper-V based switches and abilities. We have a private, which just allows VM-to-VM communication. We have internal, which allows VM-to-VM and to host, basically a host loopback in a sense. And then we actually have external, which allows that virtual machine to access the outside world. These are just standard kind of virtual switches that we have that we can use this. You can even assign them VLANs, although in the GUI you can only assign it to a single VLAN ID using PowerShell. And you see an example of a PowerShell script on the slide right now. You can actually assign them multiple VLANs for those VNICs. So we do support it. It's a matter of how you might provision it. So if you've been ignoring PowerShell, we're already in the PowerShell 3.0, and I think 4.0 is on the horizon. And I'm sure 5.0 is being worked on by our good friends Ed Wilson and the scripting guys up at corporate. So learn PowerShell, folks, if you haven't got a chance to do it. It's something that will save you time regardless of whether you're using Hyper-V or VMware. We have a lot of abilities to do some of that basics. But when I look at that, you know, it's not what I would call the standard switch. One of the things that happens underneath the covers is that we have a layer 2 networking switch. And this is where you're going to see some big differences between how we do things compared to VMware. And the actual comparison slide that we'll have in a second will kind of outline that for you. But the Hyper-V extensible switch that we have built into the Hyper-V servers themselves compared to the vStandard switch, or just the vSwitch, it's not the virtual distributed switches that you have in VMware. To do those types of things, that's where VMM, or in your case, vCenter comes into play as well. So we'll talk a little bit about that later. But understand we're talking about just kind of a standard switch environment. So don't beat me up too bad and say, well, Matt, that doesn't do all these things. Well, this is just what's built in the Hyper-V itself. We have those abilities to work with those types of things. But what makes us different here is how we can do the same kind of stuff. If you look at it, we do bind to a physical NIC or a team. We can bypass it if we're using SROV. We can do the same kind of things that VMware does, but we approach it in a very different way. We actually give it the ability to kind of make a lot of settings, and I'll show you where some of these are to put DHCP guard protection on that. If you're not familiar with DHCP guard protection, it's designed to help protect against man-in-the-middle types of attacks. If somebody has a rogue DHCP server sitting around, intercept requests, this prevents that. We can do network traffic monitoring. We can use PowerShell and WMI interfaces to do all kinds of things inside the switch. But really how we approach it is best illustrated by kind of how we look at it in this slide here. What happens with our switch, and this is where we get to a big difference, we don't actually, whenever somebody has something new, like maybe Cisco comes out with a new piece of hardware that we want to work with for our actual networking and our physical networking or environment, we don't actually replace kind of a Hyper-V switch for that. We actually just extend it. At a very high level, the analogy that I use when I talk about the extendable switch and the types of things you can do with it is very similar to what we did with printers back in the day. You remember back in the old Windows days, if you had multiple printers from different manufacturers, you had the DLL nightmare, and each would bring their own spooler to play. They'd bring their own tools to play. And Windows, kind of when you had all those multiple spoolers for different kind of printers, just would choke. It wouldn't work really well. Eventually, Windows became mature enough, we basically said, hey, look, we got your spooler here. You just plug in and extend whatever your printer does, but right to the certain API set that we're going to give you, and it allows us to print to that types of things. Well, imagine the same kind of things we do with networking. We actually provide this open and extensible switch that allows customers to bring in whatever kind of switch that they have that allows it to extend those different types of things that that switch may do. It might do forwarding extension. It might do filtering extensions. It allows us basically to plug into our networking model to get that consistent feel. So it gets to the point that to some extent that we really don't necessarily care from a Hyper-V perspective what you're doing on that physical side to make your network sync. We're going to be able to be friendly with it and be able to extend that switch. We support NDIS filter drivers for extensions, and we can also do things with the Windows filtering platform to call out those drivers that people bring in. And we actually support a lot of the common providers here in this thing, and there's several partners. Cisco's Nexus 1000, which is probably, if I were to poll the thousands of you that were on this call, I would imagine probably a hefty percentage is using the Cisco device and probably a Nexus device, especially if you're using that. But you see the other ones. We actually allow that extension very, very nicely inside of our virtual environments. So when you compare it, lots of yeses here. The difference is that we don't actually replace it. Ours is open and extensible. So it's kind of geared to not only what the networking gear does today, but what that networking gear is going to do tomorrow. Whereas VMware, they kind of replace those different things, and you get those cute little balloons when you have the Cisco switch embedded into that driver. But we actually don't do those types of things, and that's where I think fundamentally you'll see the biggest difference in how you accomplish things with virtualization in Microsoft technologies versus virtualization in VMware technologies. We approach networking very, very different of how we do those types of things. But at the end of the day, if you look at the list, especially when you compare Hyper-V to Enterprise Plus, it's a lot of yeses, and we accomplish the same types of tasks. We just go about it in a very different method. And one of the things, and I'm sure Tommy will probably talk about this later, is that this is one of those learning curves. This is one of those things that you're going to kind of have to learn how we do the networking to understand it. But at the end of the day, we offer that same kind of feature parity that you're used to seeing. We also have the ability inside of here to do a lot of things from our virtual guests. So kind of a comparison to our original slide that we had before, if you look at the differences that we have inside of our servers, it's actually pretty minimal of the differences that we have other than the types of sizes of VHDs. But for the most part, they're the same types of stuff that we support inside our virtual guests. The types of things that we can actually do in our guests versus the types of things that you may not do. So when you look at this list, just understand our VMs are very, very friendly. So what I want to do right now is I actually want to take you through and actually show you a bit. So I'm going to hop into my demo environment. So I'm just going to share out a virtual lab environment I have. And there it is. And I'll give it a second to load up inside the screen. if I can get Tommy or Eric just to give me a high sign in the live meeting chat that it's live, that everybody's seen it, and then I'll go.
Yeah, it takes a little bit for it to come up here.
Okay.
So it is just about there. It's just about there. You can go ahead.
All right. Thank you, Eric, very much. So right now I'm inside a Hyper-V manager, and this is where I have my things that we have. And we're going to talk about networking first. I'm just going to hop into the virtual switch manager. Notice that I have my different switches that I have, by internal or private. And if I say, let's just create an internal virtual switch, it's going to give me the abilities to enable that VLAN identification. Notice that we only have that one choice here, but with PowerShell, you could do these types of things. You can also set the classification. Once again, this is just the basics of networking that we have. So when we look at this and you create those types of storage environments, you have the ability to do some real basic things here. We're going to show you a little bit later when we get into VMS. We have some time to show you a little bit more of what happens with the networking under the covers. The more exciting thing is inside of Hyper-V Manager, if I just right-click on this and go into Settings, here's where you can start to get in to configure all the different types of things that we have inside of Virtual Machine Manager. Notice the different types of hardware. And right now, kind of a trivia question I could ask everybody is, what generation of virtual machine is this? Is this a Generation 1 or a Generation 2? This is actually a Generation 1. I know that because the legacy network adapter shows up in that list for me. And more importantly, I have an IDE controller. We actually have a Generation 2 that we introduced in R2. Provide some enhanced performance for our virtual machines. But this one is just Generation 1, which for what we're doing right now is perfectly fine. So one of the things that we talked about was memory. Here's where you can come in and actually configure the different memory. We can give it the startup RAM, and we can give it minimum maximum. And you might be noticing or curious, why is my startup RAM more than my minimum memory for that system? Well, generally speaking, when you start servers inside your environments, they need more RAM to actually turn on and get going than they actually may actually use on an average basis. You know, and then I notice I have the minimum maximum memory set up for this particular virtual machine. And, well, how do I know that? And that's where using tools like Performance Monitor is going to give you indication, or even Hyper-V Manager. It's going to tell you how much memory you've assigned and how much memory the actual virtual machine is using. So just doing some basic memory and baselining here will tell you what numbers you need to put in here. But once again, folks, you want to plan this out very, very well so that you don't ever run out of physical RAM on your servers, because that just becomes a slow day for all your actual different environments that we have inside of here. So notice we also have the memory weight. We can control who gets more memory. So when you think about which VM do you like more or has higher priority, you can control who should get the memory and who shouldn't, that type of thing. Our virtual processors, we have the virtual procs that we can add into the system. One important thing I always like to point out is compatibility. One of the nice things, if you have processors of the same family, Intel to Intel or AMD to AMD, what happens when you move one virtual machine from host A to host B? Well, that's where compatibility can come in to help you, especially if you're doing things like live migration or aka vMotion, something Tommy will talk about in the next section. But you want to make sure you're doing that physical compatibility, especially if you're moving to a different architecture. And what happens is our modern OSs will actually detect those changes and extend that drive for us. Here's my SCSI controller. Just one thing that I could actually do, if this virtual machine was running, I could actually add in a virtual server, a virtual hard drive hot, right from within inside of here, inside of my Hyper-V manager. So it gives me the ability to add additional storage for me to use very, very easily inside of it. Oops, I hit cancel instead of just moving past that. Let me go back into settings here real quick. Notice we have our diskette drives. If anybody has those virtual floppy drives floating around, we can still do that. I'm kidding, by the way. We have our VM networking that are here. Notice I can choose if I want to connect it. Do I want to do LAN identification? I have the ability to do hardware acceleration. And what you see with a lot of things that's happening in the virtualization space, it's actually really, really exciting. When you think about virtualization, one of the great things that the people are trying to do is think about, why do we virtualize, right? So we could do more on those servers. We could actually leverage more memory, more processor by doing different functional workloads without them trampling on each other. But what we found is the more and more we virtualized, the farther we got away from our hardware, wait, things got slower. But what you see happening from VMware and from Hyper-V, from both sides of us, is if we have hardware that can perform a certain task, like Tommy talked about, offloaded data transfer, why should Hyper-V get in the middle of moving a virtual machine from a piece of storage to another one? It should. right? What you see is a lot of things wherein, hey, bypass the hypervisor layer. Do not collect $200. Do not go to go. Go directly to jail, right? In other words, go directly to the hardware. So what you see here in the hardware acceleration is kind of our way of saying, hey, what? You have network hardware that does that has certain sections. So maybe that network hardware has an encryption type of chipset where you can do IPsec. We can actually tell this virtual machine saying, hey, don't try to do it inside your OS. Just send it right down to the network card. Why? Because it's probably going to be faster for you to work with it. We have failover TCP IP. I know Tommy's going to demo replica, so I'm going to save that for later for him and those types of things. So we have the ability here to work with our different services. And we can control the locations of our smart page locations and different things, control the actions of what happens if things turn on, so we control startup order. Now, bear in mind, this is just the basics of the tool that we have. I want to give you just a quick little tease and show you what this looks like inside a virtual machine manager. So here I have System Center Virtual Machine Manager 2012 R2. And notice I have the same virtual machines for me to look at. I'm just going to right click on one, and I'm going to go into properties here. And this is going to show me the different types of things that we have inside of here, what the status is. Currently it's turned off. It's not working. Here's my hardware configuration. This should look familiar. This is just what we configured or saw, in a sense. We have the availability, whether this is going to be a highly available switch or not. And I can also create a new one, or I can save this. And what this does inside of VMM is that you're generally going to have hardware that's going to have a same kind of common hardware footprint. What you can do is save this as a hardware profile that you can assign to new virtual machines that you can create. So we have the ability to save that kind of information, but for the most part, this is the same kind of stuff. And if you take the networking here, this looks a lot different. And this is where you start getting the you know it from a VMware perspective as the distributed networking components. But that's where VMM can start doing that virtualized network for us and do some of those segments that are here. So this looks a lot different than what you might be used to seeing. But we still have the ability to browse and change the different VM networks that are here. We have the same kind of things around our hard drive, how much storage we're going to have. Do we want to compact that drive? Notice our memory switch almost looks identical to what we've had before. So you have the ability to come in and really see some different properties. So depending on how you're looking at your virtual machine and your virtual machine settings, whether you're in VMM or Hyper-V Manager, you're going to have a different look and feel. But at the end of the day, it's still the same kind of stuff that we have. So I'm going to go ahead and just stop this demo real quick. But I wanted to give you a quick tour of the different types of things that we can do.